Hinayana or Nikaya Buddhism, a short introduction. Hello, this is Dr. Bin Song at Washington College. The teaching of the historical Buddha, Siddhartha Gautama, was transmitted orally after his demise among Buddha's followers. It was not until the 1st century BCE that these teachings were codified in written forms, firstly in Pali and then in Sanskrit. However, through reading these codified Buddhist teachings, it is clear to today's scholars that Buddhism evolved quite a bit after the time of the Buddha. Around the 3rd century BCE, there was one flourished type of Buddhist teaching and practice which had been named as Hinayana Buddhism by later types of Buddhism. Hinayana means small vehicle, and compared to great vehicle, namely the Mahayana Buddhism, which developed later, Hinayana Buddhism was thought of as one inferior form of Buddhist teaching. Since being named by its ideological competitor, no affiliate with the so-called Hinayana Buddhism would be happy about this name. In fact, this earliest type of Buddhism continues to spread and propagate. It is the origin of the dominant form of Buddhism in contemporary South Asia called Theravada Buddhism. Therefore, in order to avoid the sectarian and derogatory word Hinayana Buddhism, historians are increasingly inclined to use another more neutral term, Nikaya Buddhism. Nikaya means many collections, groups, or schools, referring to the fact that varying interpretations of Buddha's teaching existed shortly after his death. As mentioned, the contemporary form of Nikaya Buddhism is Theravada Buddhism in South Asia, and Theravada means the elders. Named as such, this lineage of Buddhism is not only literally the eldest among all, but quite conservative in its philosophy, moral codes, and organizational form. The teaching of Nikaya Buddhism is highly organized. It passed out the Four Noble Truths preached by the historical Buddha in almost a Q&A format. For instance, to explain the origin of human suffering, Nikaya Buddhism propounded two basic existential traits of all beings, impermanence and no-self. For each claim of these traits, it will furthermore provide arguments. Overall, these teachings were used to account for the reality of which human beings are led to keep ignorant and therefore incur a slew of sufferings to themselves. After the diagnosis of human sufferings, how can we get rid of their causes? The answers given by the text of Nikaya Buddhism are summarized as eightfold path: right view, right resolve, right speech, right conduct, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right meditation, which are furthermore divided into three categories: wisdom, moral conduct, and meditation. If we look into the details of the prescribed moral conduct and meditation, we find that although being centered upon the very charming ethic of universal compassion, these prescriptions are very otherworldly oriented, since they champion the monastic life featured by celibacy, moderate asceticism, and intellectual uniformity. And hence, they also doubt the value of family and state life to individuals' spiritual growth. Organizationally, compared to the commitment of Mahayana Buddhism to the equal status of lay people and monks regarding their ability to achieve nirvana, the ultimate goal of Buddhist practice, Nikaya Buddhism maintains a more rigid boundary between monks and lay people. The practical ways for normal human beings to achieve nirvana and thus be saved from the endlessly tormenting process of samsara seems to be envisioned by Nikaya Buddhism as in such a following process. If you are a normal person in a normal household and you want to achieve nirvana or simply get a nicer birth in your next life cycle, then either you use your own wealth to support a group of monks so that their merits of spiritual achievement can be transferred to your own, or you must leave the household to join them, to become a monk or nun so as to actually practice Buddhism for the purpose of ultimate salvation. Even if you really become a monk or nun, the historical Buddha is for you not a deity. You will mainly rely upon your own teacher in the religious order, the transmitted oral or written Buddhist teachings, and your own efforts to elevate your spiritual strength. So, why were Nikaya Buddhism and its modern-day offspring of Theravada Buddhism more conservative compared to other forms of Buddhism? Ideologically, it is less speculative, more organized, and in a certain sense more practical, since many of its raised points of thought are like psychiatric menus to treat specific diseases or mental health. Morally, it is more stern and ascetic, and organizationally, the rigid boundary between the religious and secular worlds is very visible. Virtually in all fronts mentioned above, Buddhism appears to be either revised or enriched by its later development, particularly by varying Mahayana schools that flourished in countries and areas of East Asia, such as the ancient China, Tibet, Korea, and Japan. However, even so, some fundamental understanding of the historical Buddha's teaching formed in the period of Nikaya Buddhism remain quite consistent throughout history, such as the starting point of Buddhist thinking on human suffering, the veneration towards monastic life, the distance from the secular all to human world, etc. In the following, philosophically, I will specify one central point of Nikaya Buddhism and its arguments for it, since beyond the initial treatment of the point by Nikaya Buddhism, I do not find much extra types of arguments for it in later Buddhism. And the point is also absolutely crucial for us to understand Buddhist thought in general. The point made is that nothing has a self unrelated to something else, and thus human suffering is caused by our unfulfilled desires of things in themselves are misplaced, since, firstly, there is no such an independent, isolated, selfed thing to cause suffering, and secondly, there is no such an selfed human to bear suffering. There are three major arguments made by the text of Nikaya Buddhism, as indicated by the assigned reading, to argue for the idea of no self. Firstly, nothing is impermanent, and therefore no way to define a self for anything, since all things constantly change. Secondly, each thing comprises of components, and thus on top of these components, there is no self of this thing. Among the most frequently invoked examples are that apart from parts of chariot, such as the wheels, yokes, straps, etc., there is no such a thing called a chariot, and that if you continue to peel away the layered petals of a cabbage, there is really no such a cabbage to remain. And therefore, apart from those layered petals, there is no such a selfed thing called a cabbage. Thirdly, there is a distinctively Buddhist idea called a codependent origination, to imply that all things derive from a process of codependent emergence. Therefore, apart from those conditions that originate a thing, that thing cannot exist. In other words, there is no such a self thing which can exist apart from those conditions upon which it depends. This argument can be thought of as a further development of the second one, since all components of a thing can be seen as belonging to the cluster of conditions that originate a thing. In a metaphysical approach, these three arguments are actually not that difficult to refute. Firstly, things indeed constantly change. However, for the period that one thing exists, namely from its birth to death, there is always one way to define its stable character in distinction from other things. For instance, no matter how a tree changes from a seed to a full-shaped being, there is a way to distinguish the tree from other plants during the time when it is alive. Therefore, it is not a legitimate inference from perpetual changes of all beings to the conclusion that one thing cannot be distinguished from another, and thus cannot have a self. Secondly, components cannot account for the whole existence of a being, since a being is quite often more than the sum of its parts. This is particularly true for organic beings, since beyond all visible parts that comprise a being, it needs an invisible principle, power, or simply structure to integrate these components as a whole. A tangible example is a soccer team. Stripped of his or her connection to the team as a whole, no soccer player can be a soccer player. However, even if we call on all the needed players to stand in line, this is still not a soccer team, which in the final analysis is exactly about how something beyond the discrete soccer players can organize them as a whole. Sometimes we use the phrase, the spirit of a soccer team, to designate the organizing principle or power, which is surely beyond the lump sum of a bunch of separate players. Thirdly, the fact that all conditions originate the birth of a being does not entail that apart from those conditions, there is nothing new about the generated being. In other words, the generation of a being cannot be reduced entirely and without any remainder to its originating conditions. Otherwise, the world is just a repetition of pre-existing conditions, and nothing new will ever take place, which prima facie is absurd. The reason I enumerated my counter-arguments above is not intended to deny the value of the Buddhist idea no self altogether. Instead, I just want to remind my readers that among traditions of world philosophies and religions, there are varying views of self. The Buddhist one may be correct, but in order to defend it, Buddhist thinkers needed to confront possible critiques such as the ones I just raised. However, according to my knowledge of Buddhism, why it can be so appealing to many practitioners is not mainly because of its sophisticated philosophical arguments. Through the history of Buddhist thought, the practical commitment to releasing humans from suffering is always favored over philosophical sophistication. More importantly, the experiential, salvific approach to meditation is quite often thought of by Buddhists as being more thorough and effective than any philosophical speculation. Seen from this perspective, it may be up to individuals to decide whether the Buddhist wisdom or no self works. And I would conclude that the teaching may indeed work in the area of individual's inner psychology, so that the philosophical entanglement with the concepts and arguments would be seen by Buddhist practitioners as too off the track to be hated. If this is the case, then as what many religious traditions in the world turn out to be, the tension between religious practice and philosophy would become, again, visible.